Hey, good morning, everyone. The good news is I almost sound like Darth Vader there for a second. Hey, the good news is we'll wait for the good news. Actually, I was just going to make a quick announcement because we were talking this week, and I know most of you guys have been listening to the crazy bleed over we've been having here on Sunday mornings. It's been distracting. I don't hear it up here, but I know you guys do. For you guys who don't know what's going on, there's a local radio station's transmitter that actually bleeds into our system, and it's hit or miss when it happens. So I don't know who's – sometimes there's sermons going on, and the other day I was listening to a kind of a hell and brimstone message, so I was like, man, go ahead, you know, do your thing, but it is a radio station that bleeds through, so I don't hear it this morning. I don't know if anybody hears it this morning, so I think we got the problem kind of fixed, and so hopefully it goes away. So that's what that noise is if you do hear something coming over through the speakers. Just a couple quick announcements. The directory, if you guys want to be in the church directory, there's some forms out here you can fill out. Just put down whatever information you want on those forms, and you can see Rachel for pictures. Or if you want to update your picture that's in the current directory, just see her, and we can do that. Our two life groups this week, remember them, Noah's House Life Group on Tuesdays from 7 to 8:30 has been going really well. It's a men's life group that meets up there. We eat around 6:15 or so, 6:30, and then we do a Bible study after that. And then the life group down at the Dotson home in Hagerstown, 7 to 8:30. So that's basically all we have for some announcements today. I would encourage you guys to take part, men specifically, for the life group on Tuesdays, if you can come up there. But going to Stephen's house, I'm hearing is a blessing for those that are attending. This morning, if you note takers, I have some PowerPoint prepared, but I want to have some kind of a leeway this morning to kind of free me up from PowerPoint and just kind of going down through the PowerPoint and talk about something this morning. And for you that are visiting with us, we're in a series that I've titled Our Identity in Christ. And so we're looking at some things, some marks on our life, what it looks like if we are in Christ. So we're going to spend a little bit of time on this fifth point, this idea of people of truth. We've been talking about truth and what that looks like, truth setting us free, then to be worshipers of God. We looked at that conversation in John 4 where Jesus had with the Samaritan woman, and then ultimately the conversation he had with Pilate in John 18 where he was confronted there by Pilate. Pilate had some questions, and Jesus just told him, you know, that he came to bear witness to the truth. And so we've been talking about what truth is. You know, in this series, we're going to spend a little bit of time in this. So 1 Peter chapter 2, 9 through 12, we probably at some point, we always read this before we start, so at some point you guys probably can come along with me if you're memorizing this, because we look at it every morning that we look at this. So 1 Peter 2, 9 through 12, Peter says this. He says, but you are not like that, for you are a chosen people, you are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, and now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. Dear friends, I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very souls. Be careful to live properly among your unbelieving neighbors. Then even if they accuse you of doing wrong, they will see your honorable behavior and they will give honor to God when he judges the world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we can gather as believers here this morning, Lord, to come and to worship you, to remember what you have done for us, Lord, setting us free from the bondage of sin, Lord, paying the penalty of it, Lord, creating in us a heart of worship, because, Lord, that's what you're looking for, is those that would worship you both in spirit. Lord, in truth, I pray that you would find us to be a people of truth, Lord, that we desire truth, that we're pursuing it, Lord, and we know that truth is found in you, Christ. Lord, help us, Lord, to live that day by day, Lord, as this Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of truth, will speak in and through our lives, always pointing us to Christ. We thank you for this morning, Lord. We ask you to speak to us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So we've been talking about a couple Sundays ago this idea of what truth is. And so, we looked at that conversation in John chapter 4 that Jesus had with the Samaritan woman or the woman at the well. And so he's just kind of going back and forth with her as Jesus did with people as he had conversations with them, drawing some things out and then always swinging some spiritual stuff into their lives. And so that's what he did with her. And ultimately what he said is that I'm the Messiah. You know, I'm the one that has brought truth. And if you're going to worship God, you're going to worship in spirit and truth. And I'm the one, he says, basically that you're going to worship. And so this morning what I want to look at is, and we talked about this last Sunday a little bit based off of John chapter 8, 31 and 36, a conversation that he had there with some people. You know, as I kind of reread it this week, just trying to figure out really who Jesus is talking to there. The Pharisees or these religious leaders, I think, are in play because they're there. But there's also these people that Jesus refers to there as those who believed in him, the Jews that were listening to him. And so, you know, maybe the conversation is kind of just the Pharisees, Christ, those that are believing in him as he's talking to them. But in John chapter 8, starting there in verse 31, this is part of that conversation that he's having with them. And he talks about this idea of truth and what truth will do. It says there, Jesus said to the people who believed in him, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free." And so they replied, and the ones that I think that are replying here, I think are probably the Pharisees or the religious people. He said, "But we are descendants of Abraham," they said. "We have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean you will set us free?" Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave of sin. A slave is not a permanent member of the family, but a son is part of the family forever. So if the son sets you free, you are free indeed." You know, and I like that there in verse 35, because what I believe that he's talking about here, because if this is the Pharisees, and I believe that it is, them speaking, they're connecting their religious experience or their religion to being descendants of Abraham. And the thing that they're missing, I think, they're more connecting it on the physical line of Abraham instead of the spiritual. Because he's going to go on later on and say that if you were children of Abraham, you would believe what I would have to say. And because they weren't spiritually connected to Abraham, then they were slaves to sin. They weren't willing to be set free and to be brought into the family of God. And that's what Jesus is talking about here in this section, is this idea of being set free and brought into the family of God, ultimately making people his disciples, it says there in verse 31. I like that. You are truly my disciples. You sense a relationship there when Jesus is talking with them. And if you remain faithful to my teachings, you sense relationship there as we obey the teachings, you know, of the Lord. And so last Sunday, as I was thinking about this, the last Sunday in my mind, I was kind of putting some things together, looking at this, where Jesus talks about this idea of freedom, that we're set free to, you know, for a number of things if your mind kind of roams through the Scripture. And so last Sunday we talked about the idea that we are set free from sin. We're set free from the bondage of sin. We're set free from the penalty of sin. And we looked at Romans chapter 6, 10 through 18. If you guys take notes, we had it last Sunday. And then verse 22 through 23. Actually, the whole entire section, chapter 6 of Romans, talks about this idea of us being set free from sin. We no longer are bound in sin. And then Colossians 2, 13 and 14, Paul tells us there that Christ actually nailed our sins to the cross. He removed the penalty of our sins, and now we've been set free from that. And so as I was thinking about this idea of freedom, what we've been set free from, and this idea of us having identity in Christ, you know, what does that do for us? You know, and ultimately what it does is that, like I said, the conversation there in John chapter 4, Jesus was having with the woman at the well, it sets us free to become worshipers of God. And as I was praying this week, and how God, the Lord often does with me, I think I've got a pretty slick message put together. You know, my points put together, and he sometimes changes those points, especially if I think I've done it in my own strength. And so he did that for me this week, because I had some, you know, this idea of being set free from death and being set free from the enemy's control. There's a lot, all that, that's all truthful. It's in the Scripture. But this is what he spoke to me about specifically there in John chapter 8 in verse 33, what I just read. So he's talking about being there, you know, being his disciple, being set free by his teaching. And when they respond back to him, and I believe it's these Pharisees, the religious folks, respond back to Christ. There in John 8, 33, says, "But we are descendants of Abraham." In essence, what they're saying there is, we have our religion. This is my religion. We're the children of Abraham. Other places they'll talk about, you know, following the teaching of Moses, you know, the first five books of the Bible. We are a people of the book. We are, you know, and if you understand the Pharisees, and we're not going to get into them this morning, but they were, you know, the top level religious folks that Jesus many times confronted. They confronted him. And if we think about some of the negatives on their side, there's a lot of stuff. And we're going to look at this morning, actually, some things that they were about. That Jesus was identifying in their life. But I had to be honest with myself because there's some positives in these guys' lives that, to be honest, I'm kind of jealous about. They were zealous for God. You know, that's a good thing. Now, they kind of went another route with that. But they were, and the idea of the Pharisee is the word is separatist. They were separated from the world, and we're called to do that, not being yoked with unbelievers, not being yoked with the things of this world. We are to be separated. It's what, you know, what we looked at there in 1 Peter 2 and verse 11 there. It says, "Dear friends, I warn you, as temporary residents and foreigners, we're to be separated from the things of this world." So there are some good things that were in the lives of the Pharisees, and the Pharisees weren't all bad guys. You know, I spent some time just looking at Nicodemus's life, and we talked about that conversation in John 3, when we looked at one of those identifying marks as being a new creation or born again in Christ. And I believe as you look down through that, that Nicodemus came, I think, with a pretty good heart. You know, was he frightened? Was he scared? Why did he come at night? I mean, we can only speculate, but at least he came, and he began to ask questions, and Jesus began to speak to him. And ultimately, in John 7, you'll see him actually sticking up for Christ, sticking up for Jesus when they're trying to falsely arrest him. And then in John 19, him and Joseph of Arimathea did some things with his body. You know, the scripture really doesn't tell us what happened to Nicodemus. I like to believe that he became a follower. We don't know. The scripture doesn't tell us that. But at least Nicodemus, being a Pharisee, seemed like a decent guy. They weren't all bad guys. And so what I want to talk about this morning, what I believe that the Lord laid on my heart, is that Christ has set us free from religion. Religion. And so we can pick at, and we're going to look at these sections. So, I mean, if you got your Bibles, and it's not going to be on the screen, because I was coming up with a couple things at the end at this, what religion looks like in comparison to what a relationship with God looks like. What religion looks like and what a relationship with God looks like. And I don't want to point fingers, you know, I don't want to beat what we're going to look up, these Pharisees up, these scribes up too much, because as we go down through this, as I was going down through this, there were parts of what I was looking at as Jesus was speaking at them that sometimes I find in my own life. So we're going to, this is what I got to be careful with, because we're looking at Jesus coming against the religion that he established. But what I want to talk about this morning is what I refer to as the religion of Christianity. What is the difference between, you know, just church and the religious, I guess, the religiosity of what church it becomes and what this relationship that really Christ came to free us from all that, to draw us into a relationship with the Lord. And as I was thinking about that, you know, I was thinking about that section in John chapter 17 and verse 3, where Jesus, as he was praying prior to his arrest, was praying to the Father. He says, "And this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent." So this is what eternal life looks like. You know, it's not this idea of and there's truth to that we've been set free from sin, that we know we're not en route to hell, you know, looking at those kind of things, and there's truth to that. But ultimately, when I look at this, what Jesus is freeing us from, and when we come to know Christ, is for us to have a relationship with him, to restore what was broken in Genesis, all the way back to Genesis 3, this eternal life. And I believe that eternal life starts now. We can experience parts of that as we move forward ultimately into eternal life. And we're going to be living on into eternity. But he says there in John 17 and this 3, this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And as he prays that, I believe there's a reason why he adds it. He could have simply just prayed that they might know you and they might know me. But he says that they might know you, the only true God. He clarifies that. Because that's why I believe when Jesus was speaking to the woman at the well, he says they must worship in spirit and truth. We talked about like what that looks like. They can never be separated, because we can be very emotional with the spirit can be operating, But we can begin to operate and to worship and to praise a wrong God, or at least a God of our own making, you know, and if it's not lined up with Scripture. You know, I've had, part of this was, I'll be honest with you, was some frustration I was having a little bit this week, just talking to people, no one here, but, you know, some friends I have, you know, talking about Christianity and God and all that, and they would say things to me that were actually contradicted God's Word. You know, I was having a conversation with my wife about this, and I'm like, this is just, you know, as I'm looking at this, I'm like, how does people get to a place when, you know, I they're good brothers and sisters of mine. They're outside, like I said, they're outside the storehouse. They're other friends I have. Get to a place in following and believing things that actually contradict the Bible. And as I begin to just, my mind begin to search the Scriptures in this, it's because if we're honest with ourselves, and really I'm at fault for this as well, is that I don't know the truth like I should know it. I don't know God's Word like I should know it. I'm not a person of the Word like I want to be. And that kind of stuff begins to sneak in. The enemy's very clever. His voice is still the same voice of Genesis 3. You know, did God indeed say? Did God indeed say? And people begin to slip because they don't spend time in His Word. But this is the idea of knowing Him, worshiping in spirit and truth, knowing the God that we worship, and knowing Christ whom He sent. And Jesus, and we're going to look at Matthew 15. It's not going to be on the screen, so if you want to open your Bibles to this, Matthew 15, and then we're going to flip over a couple of chapters to Matthew 23. There's a lot of accounts in the Gospel when Jesus would confront the religious folks, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes were in amongst the Pharisees, the Herodians. There's all kinds of these different religious groups that Jesus was catching their attention because he was doing things and saying things, and he was collecting a disciple. These disciples, he was collecting large crowds of people. So obviously, the religious people probably feeling as if they were that Jesus was going to take some of their folks or whatever. Begin to kind of come and talk to him and try to figure some things out, and they begin to challenge him. And then Jesus would speak into these people's lives. Matthew 15. Listen to this conversation. I've got it chopped up a little bit, so I'd encourage you to read just the chapter. But for time's sake, just I want to kind of get the gist of what they're talking about here as they're coming against Christ. This religious establishment coming against Jesus, and then Jesus' response back to them. Matthew 15, verses 1 through 3, and we'll look at the end of 6 and through 9, and then 17 through 20. It says, then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, and so they heard about him. They're moving up into the Galilee where he's at. So they're hearing about some things that's happening. It says, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they did not wash their hands when they eat. He answered them, and why do you break the commandments of God for the sake of your tradition? And then from the end of 3 to the end of 6 there, he just kind of talks about, and he uses an example of how they would get out of a commandment of honoring their father and mother. In the end of 6, he says this, so for your sake of your tradition, you have made void the Word of God. And so the traditions that they established over many years, what they did is they voided out the Word of God, because what was happening was their focus became on the traditions or the rules and the things that they set up instead of a relationship with God. And because of that, God's Word then was null or voided out. Verse 7, it continues there. It says, you hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, and he's quoting out of Isaiah 29 here, says, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain they do worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men. And then from 9 down to the beginning of 17, he just talks about, you know, what defilement looks like. You know, that they were so much concerned about what was going into the body, the washing of hands and the outward appearances of religion, instead of the heart condition. That's why Jesus said there, and he quoted out of Isaiah 29:13, you guys honor me with your lips, but your heart isn't worshiping me. Your heart's not there. And so he begins to talk about that. The disciples there in that section of verses from 9 to 17 come to him. They want Jesus to explain what he's doing and what he's saying. Verse 17 says this, do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth passes into the stomach and is expelled? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile anyone. I mean, can you see why the Pharisees were beginning now to get upset with him? He's calling them out. He says, what happens is, and we're going to look at this other section in Matthew 23, because as he, actually, it's just on the other side, we call it, you know, Easter or Palm Sunday. He moves into Jerusalem, and now he's really starting to get confronted by these guys. But he's hitting them right in the heart. They looked very religious. They had all the garb on. They moved about wanting the praise of men, wanting the people to obey them, and they begin to create all these crazy, you know, extra rules, all these extra traditions, so that the people would obey the Ten Commandments or obey the commandments of Moses or whatever. And because of that, people were more concerned with obeying the rules and all the traditions that they put into place instead of, you know, having a heart, the heart coming towards a worship with God and understanding God's word. As I was thinking about that, you know, in 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 7, when God commissioned Samuel to go out and to anoint the next king, Saul was getting ready to fall. His anointing, so to speak, as being king was in the, really getting ready to be removed. And Samuel was told to go out and to anoint the next king. And so he finds Jesse, and Jesse parades all of his, you know, strong looking, I'm sure, nice looking sons in front of him. And God's like, this isn't the one that's going to be the next king. Don't you have any other sons? And we know the story. Well, I got this 16, 15-year-old, however old David was, on the back 40, so to speak, tending the flock. And Samuel's like, well, bring him up. And that was the next king of Israel. Because in that section it says, the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. You see, Jesus, when he was looking at these religious leaders, and it's the same way for us, you know, what does he see? You know, I know Ramona, I know Oscar, I know Tim. I see the outward of everybody here, but I really can't judge your inward. I don't really know what your inward is all about. But he's the one that knows. God's the one that knows, and that's what Jesus was doing. He was exposing the heart issue of these religious folks, and that's why, you know, they were so frustrated with him and ultimately wanted to get him killed and eventually were successful, not even realizing that was the plan of God. Then if we move over to Matthew 23, back in chapter 21, Jesus now moves in to Jerusalem. He's having some confrontations. He's teaching parables about the Pharisees, calling them out. And here he speaks right into them in Matthew 23. You know, like I said, I'm going to kind of chop it up a little bit. I encourage you to read the chapter. But Matthew 23, 1 through 7, and then Matthew 23, verses 23 through 28. It's interesting, as I was thinking about really just the Gospel of Matthew, this here, and just looking at Jesus' messages or his sermons that he gave. If you go back into Matthew 5, and we know that as the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5 through the end of Matthew 7, he starts that as he teaches. There are crowds are gathering around him, but it says, and he taught his disciples. The disciples are there the closest to him, and he begins to teach them starting in Matthew 5, 1, all the way to the end of Matthew 7. I actually call that the manifesto of the kingdom. It's the procedures, the things he gives us on how to live in the kingdom, and he starts those out, and we know it. Blessed are you who? Blessed are you who? Oh, how happy is the idea behind that? And now this kind of a last sermon, this last message, so to speak, as he's directing it now at the Pharisees, now he's going to pronounce woes on them. Woe are you. You know, that's a rebuke. It's a warning as well. Woe, he's rebuking the religious people. It's primarily these scribes and these Pharisees. So listen to this, Matthew 23, starting in verse 1. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, to the crowds and to his disciples. So Jesus is using this as a teaching moment as he's going to now speak into the lives of these guys, these religious people. So he's speaking to the crowds and to his disciples. So the scribes and the Pharisees, they sit on Moses' seat. So do and observe what they tell you. See, they were biblically right, so to speak. You know, what he's saying is the things that they're telling you from the law is the word of God. But what he's eventually going to say is, though, you can listen to what they have to say, but don't practice on how they play it out. It's like the thing we've been talking about here, the learning and the living. They had zero living, no living. They had a lot of learning. They knew God's word. Now they've added to it, so to speak. So he says, do and observe whatever they tell you, but not the works they do. For they preach, but do not practice. They preach, so they're hypocrites. They preach, and they do not practice. They tie up heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to move them with their finger. And so that's one of the things that I was talking about, this idea of legalism, you know, legalism and liberty. And I think both of them are actually dangerous. There has to be a balance in there, because what legalism says is what Jesus is confronting these religious folks here. They tie up these heavy burdens hard to bear. They place all this on people's shoulders and refuse to remove it. They said, you know, you got to obey this rule, you got to obey that rule, and you got to do this, and you got to do that. And what happens is people begin to then, and I think that we got to be on guard against that. It's like, I got to go to church, and I got to read my Bible, and I got to pray, and I got to have my devotions. Oh my goodness, yesterday I forgot to read my devotions, and you know, what's God think? You see how quickly it could even affect the church. It's legalism. It's it's about rules, and Jesus came to set us free from all that. Now, the other side of the coin, so to speak, is this idea of liberty. Some will say, "Well, you know, I know God, and you know, I'm in His grace. I understand grace, and He's forgiven me, and so I can just kind of live however I want to live." If you read that section in Romans chapter 6, Paul says, "Oh no, no, you can't continue to sin expecting God's grace to cover you." He's like, "Certainly not. You can't live that way." And so if you know Christ, we are set, we have been set free. There's great liberty in our walk, but we've been set free like we talked about last Sunday. No, sin no longer controls our life. That guilt is no longer on us. We no longer have to pay that penalty. Now He has set us free to live for God. And what Jesus was saying there, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He now brings us into the household of God as part of the family of God. So we've got to be careful against hypocrisy, like these guys were. We've got to be careful against legalism. And then in verse 5, there in Matthew 23, it says this. They do all their deeds to be seen by others. For they make their phylacteries broad. It was, you know, a little box they would wear on their head with scripture references or verses in it. They make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long on their robes, is what he's talking about. Their priestly clothing. And they love the place of honor and feasts and the best seats in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplaces and being called rabbi by others. This is a pet peeve of mine. I'm going to go on a soapbox for a second, because I'm just kind of just thinking this. The Criners love this. I know we just joke back and forth. They love to call me the most holy reverend, pastor reverend, whatever. You know, it's all a joke, and I understand, but we understand that. The problem with when I look at the Bible, you know, what the position that I'm in is a position that I'm in. I don't have a title. I don't have a title. That's, you know, it's just a pet peeve. So maybe they can delete this from the audio, but it's a pet peeve of mine, and it does. But I know it's mostly Claire and Greta, but and sometimes Carson. But and I know they're joking, but there are folks out here today in the churches that love the very thing Jesus spoke against. They love the best seats. They love the titles. They love this or they love that about themselves. And what happens is the focus then becomes on them, and that's what's happening here. You know, the position that I am, when I look at Ephesians 4, it's a gifting that God gives to me. It's not a title. It's a position that He gives to me. And for me, as I look at that, you know, Ephesians 4, as I look at, Peter 5, as I look at, Timothy and Titus and the things that are being said about a person, you know, to be honest with you, it's a humbling place to be, because the call that I have on my life specifically is to live as an example to the flock, not to lord it over people. It drives me nuts when I hear of John Doe, most holy reverend, this and that and this. And it's like, what does that have to do with anything? And what happens over time, people begin to look at that. They begin to puff themselves up. And that's what Jesus was coming up against. And it's not in this, I don't have it here, but if you read the section, he said people love to be called father and rabbi and this and that. He said, you don't call anybody that. We only have one teacher, and that's Christ. God uses people. You get the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, pastors, teachers, and there's a little, you know. But you have the same spirit that I have living in you that teaches you as well. But they love it. They love to be puffed up. Verse 23, woe to you, He's rebuking them, woe to you, and warning them, I believe, as well. Because I still think he loved these guys. I know he still loved these guys. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint and dill and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters. You see, they're about religious things. They're making sure that their 10% tithe gets in the box every Sunday. But behind it, there's no heart. So you're tithing of everything, but you've neglected the weightier matters of the law, the more important things, the things where the heart, remember, Jesus is dealing with the heart of people, justice and mercy and faithfulness. He's not taking away from the fact that they're to give, because he says, these you ought to have done, you should have done this, without neglecting the others. You know, if we don't live in justice, if we don't live merciful towards people, if we don't live in faithfulness towards God and towards people, God's not so much concerned about the tithing of the mint and the dill and the cumin and the religious activity and what we wear and whatever we do in church. It's a heart issue. Jesus came to free us from that, to worship him and not to be caught up in religion. He goes on there in verse 24 and says this, you blind guides, straining out a gnat and swallowing a camel. You know, they were trying to live such a kosher diet that, you know, they would use straining rags to make sure that they didn't swallow a gnat. That's how meticulous they got about trying to follow God, rules, and there was no heart there. Not even realizing, he says, and just kind of a play there, that you swallow a camel. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. See, our heart always should be, is Lord, examine me. Psalm 139, we've talked about that at length here over different types of studies. Lord, look into my heart. Is there any wicked way in me? Expose those things in my life, the inner part. You know, the writer of Hebrews says that one day we will all stand and give an account before the Lord, who sees the very intents, the thoughts and the intents of our heart. Everything it says will be laid open and bare. It's a heart issue. It's not the outward. It's not putting on the outward show. That's what Jesus was speaking against these religious folks. Clean the inside of the cup and the plate that the outside may also be clean. It says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you like whitewashed tombs. You're like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and uncleanness. So you also outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. You see, Jesus, when he was speaking to them, it's the same as God was speaking into the book, you know, through Ezekiel, as he was looking into the priests back then. God was digging into the innermost recesses of people's hearts and what they're doing. You know, it doesn't necessarily, what we do here on Sunday morning is important, and we're to gather together, we're to worship the Lord together, we're to come and to learn his word together. But God is looking at what the heart issue of why we come here. He's looking at what we do when we leave here on Sunday. You know, how are we worshiping him Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you know, the rest of the time, you know? And I think we got to be careful sometimes as the church that we begin to fall back into this kind of a system of just checking off religion, because God is wanting this relationship with us, and it comes through Christ. So I don't point my fingers too hard at these guys, because to be honest with you, as I picked down through both Matthew 15 and Matthew 23 and looking at this, there were some things in here that, you know, that I had to check myself against. You know, Lord, how is my heart before you? You know, am I putting on an appearance of being more godlier than I really am? Or am I trying to do that? Or is there a false humility about me? You know, as you lay yourself open before the Lord like that, you know, I believe he comes and he ministers to us. You know, I was sharing this with, I think, Trace, because I heard this somewhere, so I was kind of looking and searching for this. It's going to be kind of funny to us, but I mean, it's still kind of serious. You know, I was thinking about Exodus chapter 20. It's the fourth commandment. It says, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. And so I remember reading about some of this extra biblical, these rules that the Pharisees, the religious people, would put on people in order just to simply obey that one commandment. I mean, it's pretty self-explanatory if you read it. I mean, just don't do any work on the Sabbath. But it's a heart issue. It's about worshiping God on that day, remembering all that he's done for them. As I was looking it down through a list, and there's a huge list of stuff that this extra writing that they would write, and they're comical. One of them that I read that they had to obey in order to keep the fourth commandment was they weren't allowed to spit on the Sabbath. They weren't allowed to spit on the Sabbath. Because if they spit, and the spit hit the dirt, and the spit rolled, it could then possibly be making a brick of mud, so they're working. So they had to be careful. I mean, it's funny. I mean, isn't it funny? But this is what the people lived underneath, and it was serious to them. Another one that I came across is they would put certain restrictions on, like, tools that they would use for construction. One of the examples was a hammer. That they had to place the hammer somewhere out of reach, somewhere where they wouldn't bump into it on the Sabbath, for if they walked by and accidentally touched it, or they saw that it needed to be moved and touched it, they defiled themselves if they did it on the Sabbath. That was a rule that was put on them. Another one that I ran into as I was reading is a tailor, someone who sews clothing. 30 minutes before the start of Sabbath, he had to make sure that he put his needle somewhere. Because if he happened to put it in his clothing, as the tailors sometimes do, and it says this, it's just kind of funny, because I mean, I don't see myself doing this, but it says, and if then he searches his clothing for fleas, he's got different issues going on, other than obeying the fourth commandment. But if he searches his clothing for fleas and forgets about the needle and runs into the Sabbath, then has to pull that needle out, he's violating the fourth commandment. And then one, this is a modern day one that's used today to keep the fourth commandment, is a refrigerator. Before the Sabbath starts, Jews today have to unscrew the light bulb in the refrigerator. Because if they go to the refrigerator on the Sabbath to open it up and to grab whatever they're going to grab out of it, if that light isn't unscrewed, when they open the door, the light comes on, and the spark or whatever happens, and it's considered to be kindling, means they're beginning to start a fire, means they're getting ready to do some work, and it's a violation. And they also can't open the door, because if warm air rushes into the refrigerator and it kicks on the compressor sparks, the compressor fires up, and the compressor now has to work. I mean, do you see how crazy? I mean, it's funny. Isn't it funny? But think of living under that. Think about that. Just let's use today as a Sabbath. I mean, what if we made rules like that on people? You all got to walk home today, because if you start your car, Rick knows, I don't know mechanics all that well, the spark plug kicks off and there's fire and there's work, you know what I'm saying? Like, how crazy would that be? And we kind of laugh at this and we kind of look at this, but that was the burden that the people had. And that's why, you know, Jesus would quote it out of, Isaiah 29. They make statements about worshiping me, but they don't worship me with the right heart. They're more concerned about doing the traditions of people. They're more concerned about rules. And what happens is when we begin to basically operate in rules, Jesus is somewhere on the back burner in that. Because we're trying to keep all this stuff going. I'm trying to do Bible study. I'm trying to pray. And all that is good. And the one thing I can appreciate, something Stephen said, I think it was last year, when he was teaching the Bible study class on just about the Bible and studying it and different things. And I'll be honest with you, he made a statement that checked me in a way that I didn't know if I could agree with what he said. But then I thought it through and I was like, oh my goodness, I'm a culprit of that. What Stephen said, and I don't know if you remember saying this, he's like, sometimes even in churches, Christians, that the Bible, this right here becomes an idol. This right here can sometimes become an idol. And I was like, what? So I kind of wrote it down. I thought it through and I prayed about it. And I started to think about that, because as I was thinking about this morning and what he had to say last year about that, how many of us will simply just sometimes go in, the day I'm reading, in Mark, and so I just crank out my chapter. And then I go about my day. And it didn't do nothing for me. It didn't do nothing for me. But I think we talked about this here recently. John chapter 5, 39 and 40, 45 through 47. Jesus spoke into this very thing. And he says, you search the scriptures because you think they give you eternal life. But the scriptures point to me. Yet you refuse to come to me to receive this life. And then 45 through 47 of John 5. And then he says, yet it isn't I who will accuse you before the Father. It says Moses will accuse you. Yes, Moses is whom you put your hopes. If you really believe Moses, you would believe me, because he wrote about me. But since you don't believe what he wrote, how will you believe what I say? So how do we take what Jesus is saying here to these folks You know, you're always searching the scriptures. You're in Bible study. You're combing the scriptures. You're studying it. You're memorizing it just to know the scripture and not even realizing that from Genesis to Revelation is talking about Jesus. This doesn't give us eternal life. This does not give us eternal life. Just simply knowing the Bible and having a Bible. Because I read this for 30 years almost, and it did nothing for me. But then when I started to read in here, and I began to look at this, like, you know, we talked about John 17:3. This is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God in Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. And what happened was, at that very moment, it says, I had to say to myself, I don't know him. Not like what he's talking about. I don't know God. I don't know Christ. And then I began to share the scriptures, and God and the Holy Spirit did a work through the Word of God, opened up my understanding to the Bible. Then I came to know Christ. My vision was, you know, I was given spiritual vision. And now as I comb through the Bible, as I read through, and I'm not perfect at it. There's still sometimes I have a Bible checklist and I fall into that. But now I'm looking for Christ. I want to have that relationship as I comb through this Bible, as I look through it. See, we can fall into religion even in the church. We can still be enslaved to that and not experience freedom. One of the most sobering places, talking about this idea of knowing Christ, to really know him, to be in a relationship with him. You know, I know my wife for at least almost, actually 26 years in May. I know her. I know things about her. When we go to a restaurant, if the choice is given to her between Pepsi and Coke, I can order for her every single time. I know what she drinks. I know what she likes. And I'm not perfect at it, so don't go talking to her about. But I've known her for 26 years. There's things I know that she likes. There's also, as I watch her engage with our kids in a different way that she engages with me, I see a side of her. So I listen to that conversation. You see, for us to grow in a relationship with Christ, I have to be able to know that Jesus drinks Coke. I'm not saying that's. I actually like Pepsi, but whatever. But I have to know that. Do I know him that way? Do I know that he drinks Coke, so to speak? When I'm around you, when I'm around Stephen or Jim, some guys that we pray and I listen to their prayer, it's the same way as I listen to Tracy engage Caleb or Rachel. As I listen to the prayer that Stephen has, he's engaging in a way. He's showing me Christ. You know, it takes a body, it takes a family to do that. But this is a sobering verse for me. I'm sure most of us are familiar with it. When Jesus is teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father, being obedient to the Father's will, who is in heaven. On that day, the day of judgment, on that day, many, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many works in your name? You know, and you could kind of add, and we're not adding to it, but we could. But Lord, I had the King James Bible. I went to church 3 out of 4 Sundays. I did good things. You could add so much to that list. And he says this, and then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. You see, that's what the Pharisees were caught up in. Not all of them, but the majority of them were caught up in religion. They were caught up in keeping rules and doing this and doing that. You know, you can do this, but you can't do that. Instead of knowing God, being in a relationship with him. That's the rebuke that Jesus has here in that Matthew 7 section. It's not that those things are bad that they were doing. It's just they weren't doing them because they didn't know Christ. They have to know Christ. And so as we were looking at that section there in Matthew chapter 8, whom the Son sets free is free indeed, but we're children of Abraham. We have to be careful that as a church that we say, well, I go to the storehouse. I believe this. My mom and dad is a Christian. We got to be careful of that. Because it's coming to know Christ. It's being his disciple. It's abiding in his word. His word sets us free. It's in this relationship. And I'm going to close with this section in Colossians chapter 2. I'd actually ask you guys to write this one down. because I've spent a lot of time reading this, because it's a motivation for me to grow in a real relationship with the Lord, knowing Him in a personal way. You know, I don't want to stand before Him one day and say, well, Lord, I did all this and I did that, and didn't you see what I did? And for Him to say to me, we never knew each other. Colossians chapter 2, 6 and 8 through 8, and then verse 16. Listen to what it says. I would encourage you to write it down just maybe once a day or so, one time during this week. Just read through this and let it kind of speak to your heart. This is what it says. And you, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow Him. Now listen to this. Let your roots grow down into Him, not religion, but into Him. Let your roots grow down into Him, and let your lives be built on Him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth you were taught, and you will overflow with thankfulness. You see, a relationship with the Father, a relationship with Christ, the Holy Spirit's living in your life, the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5 tells us, is what? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, patience, goodness, self-control. That's what's going to be the outflow of a relationship with Christ. You will overflow with thankfulness when you know Him. Don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense. Verse 16 then says this, so don't let anyone condemn you for what you eat or drink, or for not celebrating certain holy days or new moon ceremonies or Sabbaths. You see, that church there in Colossae was almost slipping back into religion. And what Paul says here is simply this. Be on guard against that. Be on guard against following rules and traditions and things that have no power. Remember, we talked about in John 1, John says that the law was given to Moses through Moses, but grace and truth came through Christ. It's living in grace. It's knowing truth. And it's worshiping Christ in such a way that I know Him. My roots are digging down into Him. I'm being built up on Him. I'm growing in the grace and the knowledge of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Peter tells us in 2 Peter 3:18, it's Him that we're growing into. It's Him that I want to know. It's my pursuit. See, that's our identity, not religion, and even the religion of Christianity, but a relationship with Christ. He's the one that sets you free, and he's the one that that sets us at liberty to live for Him, that we no longer are people of sin or bound in it or having the penalty weighing over our head. So just be on guard against that. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You, Lord, that You look down into the situation of humanity, Lord. That, Lord, it's so easy sometimes for us to get caught up in the rules of religion. It's so sometimes easy for us to get caught up in the things of just simply doing church. And sometimes, Lord, we forget that You came that we might know You. That You came that, Lord, we might have a relationship with You, that we can grow in You, Lord. Lord, help us to be watchful against things that place heavy burdens on us. Lord, help us to just to understand and to rejoice in and to be thankful for the freedom that we have in You, Christ, to worship You, to know You, Lord, to live for You, to serve You. And that one day, Lord, we'll behold Your face. Lord, we thank You for what You're doing in our lives here, Lord. Grow us in You in a real way. In Jesus' name, amen.